We're going to start this off, and I'm Roger Addison, and with me today is?
Rick Rumler.
Good. We'll be your host for this tribute to Gary Rumler. And first I'm going to start off by, I think I have about three stories that I'm going to, short stories that I'm going to tell you about, Rick. One is that you always look at defining moments in your life where you were, and one of them was 9/11. You all remember where you were on 9/11? Mm-hmm. Well, I know where I was. I was with Gary Rumler and Margot Murray and Don Toste. We were doing an institute for ISPI, of course. We were always doing something for ISPI, and we were all in Phoenix. It was quite interesting, too, is that we asked the students if they would like to go back and join their families, and they said no, they were going to stay and finish the institute. So they all finished the institute, and we had, Margot and Don and I all had dinner together, so that was one of the defining moments. The other moment I remember when I was so pleased and really excited about is that when Gary asked me to do the preface for Serious Performance Consulting. That was one of the highlights of my life, certainly. And then in the first time I was introduced to Praxis Materials, I can go back a long ways, is when Don Toste sent me to a workshop in San Francisco in 1978. I just received my doctorate, and the first class I took out of my doctorate work was a class that Gary had done on, I don't know if you all remember those big Praxis binders. There were two of them. I still have two Praxis binders in my briefcase or in my office that I still refer to. And I still have my favorite job aid. I always told Gary that this one job aid on that saved the company several million, actually it was $10 million, by me asking the questions about on the job aid to a group of people. And they said, you know, we don't know the answer to those questions. Maybe you better find out. That changed the way we did business for many years at I was at a very large financial institution. So those are three stories with horses. I think some of you all know who that was. So those are three moments that I remember, certainly a long time before that, at ISPI. I followed Gary's work. So those are my three moments. Do you have any moments that you have one or two probably.
One or two, I can
think about.
A long string of moments. And so for those who don't know me, I am the second of Dr. Gary and Margaret Rumler's three sons and a partner in the Performance Design Lab. So happy to be have been a part of the last incarnation of Gary Rumler's companies. And I'd like to thank you for coming this afternoon because you represent the people that he was serving for five decades. And so basically, this tribute would not be complete without you being here. So I greatly appreciate that. I must confess, though, that my brothers and my mother and I were occasionally jealous of the time that he spent with you. But we learned to share the time with you, and we did benefit from the relationships that he had with all of you. So again, thank you for being a part of this, because it's very, very special that you're here for this. I can't tell you how pleased I am with the quality of the presenters we've been able to put together for this afternoon. What I was using as my gauge for the right speakers were people who could really speak to the character and contributions of Gary Rumler over his entire career. And I think we've achieved that with flying colors. So look forward to getting a chance to not only you hearing them, but I'm looking forward to hearing the stories that they have, because we've not rehearsed the stories. So that will be news. But with an average of three decades of professional and personal association with my father, these folks are going to be able to really speak to it. Now we've organized the presentations. The man at work. We've organized the presentations.
I think you have to go back to that one slide, because I think everybody remembers Gary always this way.
Yes.
wouldn't be complete without a Gary drawing.
Exactly.
So this is what I found.
Yeah, we were going to use the overhead projector just to really bring back the full. 5-color overlay, you know, and the whole treatment. Absolutely, and only after the tablet PCs came out and you could write on the screen.
You still had to have that little drawing. You remember that little drawing you had to have, the little man? Right, yeah.
So what we have for you this afternoon, and we're kind of a little bit into our time, but what we have is a 90-minute, or 80-minute as the time is now, a formal presentation where we'd like to present to you. And then we have a 30-minute informal presentation where we'd really love to hear from you what you learned from Geary Rumler. So that's what we'd like to try to do. But the informal's up. I realize we're getting tight up to the dinner hour at that point, so if you can stay, great. Would love to hear from you. But without further ado, I want to get on with the presenters. The first two presenters are Dr. Karen Searles-Breathauer and Dr. Dale Breathauer. I've literally known both of these fine people since I was knee-high to a performance consultant. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to these good people.
Thank you, Rick.
Okay, here we go. This picture of Geary Rumler in 1962 was actually taken in 1965. He might have looked younger in 62. He was a 25-year-old man from Belding, Michigan. He had engineering credits, and that was an important thing. He had this many engineering credits. That's 90 for those of you who were not counting. He also had a bachelor's degree in management. He had an MBA. He had a growing family, and he was already exhibiting three habits that define much of his career.
And those three habits are listed on the slide. You have to base things on science, manage them from data, and if it doesn't exist, build it, and build a business that pays for it. He was very committed to doing things that benefited both the client and building the technology over time. And then build the technology that assures quality and consistency and service to the clients.
His first three jobs were significant in his development. The first job was when he was working as a summer intern in an auto plant near Detroit. And he learned that a lot of things happened. People had a lot of ideas about what should be done. And if you wanted to know what was going on, you had to go look yourself, observe, get the data. His second major job, he was working in the Office of Research Administration at the University of Michigan. And he was the project representative for a project called the Audiolingual Language Programming Project. That is how I met Geary. That project was a project in which we were developing self-instructional material for 5 different languages. I ended up working on the Thai program. Geary was excited by that experience, and other people were. That experience attracted numerous investors who started the Institute for Behavioral Research and Programmed Instruction. That was Geary's first entrepreneurial experience. He was the assistant director. A man named F. Rand Morton was the senior executive.
And that's where I met Geary and Dale, actually, was in the Institute for Behavioral Research and Programmed Instruction. And that institute only lasted for 1 year. And at the end of that 1 year, the part that was making money, there was only one part that was making money, which was the workshop on programmed instruction, was picked up by one of the managers. I think he was on the board of directors, George S. Odierne in the University of Michigan, and moved to the University of Michigan Business School. Out of that experience of the IBRPI, Institute for Behavioral Research and Programmed Instruction, 2 important lessons were learned by Geary, which were that businesses can fail if not managed properly, and secondly, that good products read Profitable Workshop, can survive the death of a business. Gary established the Center for Program Learning for Business, and his work began to be noticed more broadly, Michigan, U.S., and the world. I think I went one slide too far here.
Yes, you did, but we're almost ready for that slide. But I want to tell you a little bit about the start of that workshop. Gary knew full well, as did his boss, George Odierne, that they had to beat the competition to make that thing work, which meant that they had to do it better, faster, and cheaper than anybody else could do it. And that was an externally determined design standard. Another thing that I want to tell you about that is a story of how Odierne actually started the Center for Program Learning for Business. Many of you know the story, but it's worth telling again. When the program learning workshop was going to be offered by the University of Michigan, Odierne sent out a press release announcing the workshop at the new center. As soon as he did that, he got a call from his boss, the dean of the College of Business, who said, George, you can't do that. You can't start a center that way. It has to go through many, many, many committees to establish a center. And George said, oh, I'm so sorry. What should I do with all the checks? And he started reading off names like Michigan Bell, General Motors. I've got to send these checks back. The dean said, okay, George, you've got a center, you've got sales, let's go. Now, oh my goodness, here we go. Now we're back to Karen's favorite slide. This one is, again, illustrating his commitment to science, also hard work and innovation. Everything in that first workshop was science-based. It was all very carefully engineered. To beat the competition, we had to do it in 1 week, which means we didn't have time to tell them. All we could do is show them and then help them practice doing it. We demonstrated analysis, we demonstrated criterion frames, we demonstrated teaching frames, we demonstrated developmental testing. We didn't demonstrate writing objectives. The developmental testing generates yet another story, and that story is about the developmental testing. There weren't computers in those days, so Geary had to hire a bunch of typists to type the programs on Thursday night so they could be tested on Friday morning. So they were all up late typing the programs. The participants, meanwhile, had an opportunity to go out and experience the nightlife of Ann Arbor. They hadn't had that opportunity because we worked them night and day up until that point. When they came in on Friday morning, they were bleary-eyed rather than bright-eyed. As soon as Gary noticed that problem, he put in a fix. He required them to attend an enrichment session on Thursday night in which we lectured to them on wonderful topics so that the next day they could come in and actually developmentally test.
And that's a good example of Gary's drive to learn, always. I think all the speakers will probably attest to that who are up here today. He learned from looking at what the result was of what had happened. He learned from clients. He learned from colleagues. And the colleagues that he referenced in later years repeatedly were George Odierne, who Dale has already mentioned, learned moxie, business moxie from him. And the science of behavior and data, he credited George Geis and Dale in teaching him what he could learn about that and what he used out of that. He also paid a lot of attention to what worked and didn't work with clients who attended. So some of the clients that attended are listed here. Those are people who attended the workshops, and many of them subsequently did projects. I'm going to go through the programmed instruction workshop to the end of his Michigan years in terms of how he applied that learning. Initially, in the program learning workshop, people could get results when they went back to their companies and applied whatever the training was that they were applying most of the time. But every once in a while, those results were not achieved. And one of the things that was interesting to Gary about Gary to me is his curiosity. He was as interested in what did not work as he was in what did work. So he asked that question. If they do it at the end of training, why don't they do it on the job? And that led to the second iteration, which you see here, which was looking at what they knew when they came in. In some cases, we discovered we were training them in things they already knew how to do. How valuable is that? But even more importantly, what does it take to maintain a trained behavior after they leave? And that led to a whole lot of work on the maintenance of behavior. And something that many of you have probably heard and seen and worked with, the balance of consequences. What happens when somebody actually engages in this behavior on the job? One of Gary's very powerful quotes, I think, is if you put a good performer in a bad system, the system wins every single time. And that's what the whole designing of what we might call the work environment, the management environment, was about. So that led to another workshop and the technology to figure out what did it take for any given behavior. That workshop was the management of behavior change. And once that was in place and people were using it regularly, then we discovered an unintended consequence. So, for example, when sales went up, manufacturing couldn't keep up because manufacturing was calibrated to the level of sales that had been there before. And that meant that you had upset customers. An aha moment was looking at through a lens and recognizing that one department, the department, of course, of the person who came to the workshop, was too small a lens. You had to look at the entire system and you had to balance out those consequences. That led to taking general systems theory and looking at the entire organization, but then also the context in which that organization worked, the open systems theory. What are the influences coming in from the outside? And that led to another workshop, the training systems workshop. This idea that you could look at the system level, the process or subsystem level, and the individual performer level was something that continued through all the rest of Gary's work and professional development. Personally, it's probably the most important thing that I took from those years into the rest of my work in change management and talent management as I went on for all the years since. It's still powerful. People still get surprised by it.
And that brings us to 1969. There's a lot of information on this slide about things that he had accomplished during those 7 years by attending to science and data with his entrepreneurial moxie and creating the technology to do it. He had earned a degree. He had earned his Ed Specialist degree. He had not yet quite earned his PhD. He had accomplished a very, very great deal that is shown on that slide. And that slide will be available online so that you can look at it and be impressed. Probably you didn't know that he spent a summer teaching at Catholic University. Probably you didn't know that he spent a summer teaching at Harvard University. There are a lot of things about Gary that you don't know, and you can find them on that slide, and you can find them by listening to the remaining speakers.
And at the time that he left the University of Michigan, he was 31 years old.
Rick, I think we're going to have a deal. We're trying to boil down a lifetime in 90 minutes. It's going to be fun.
Yeah, our next period are the Praxis years, and so as Dale mentioned, it was off to New York City. Thankfully, he deposited the family in New Jersey on the way to New York City, and so we made the journey with them, And with us, we have Sora Morgenstern, who was a colleague at Praxis and later at the Rumler Group as well, and a client, Bill Wiggenhorn, first with Xerox Learning Systems as a client, and then later at Motorola, so a client both at Praxis and the Rumler Group and the Rumler Brace Group.
Well, it is hard, to, as Roger said, it is hard to boil down a lifetime into 90 minutes, and I feel like I have to speed talk now to say all the things that I'd like to say. And I supposedly have slides here, but I'm not sure that what I say is going to track with the slides, so if you're a visual, you're in trouble. You know, read a novel while I'm speaking or something, but I'll do the best I can. I was an undergraduate at the University of Michigan, and I got a job as a secretary in the Center for Program Learning, which led to, I started reading the stuff that I was typing, and it looked interesting to me, and eventually I actually came in at night to do some of my work so that I would be available during the day to for more professional assignments. So I wangled my way into being an assistant in the program learning workshop. And I'd go over and work with some of the participants on their exercises during the breakouts. So that was great experience for me. But Gary had already left. He was in New York, and I never met Gary while I was at Michigan, but I certainly heard a lot about him. And then I believe it was, my husband says I don't know the chronology of my own life, so it's certainly hard for me to keep track of the chronology of somebody else's life. But it was about 1970 that the Center for Program Learning was heading out to Anaheim, California for a conference of what was then called NSPI, the National Society for Programmed Instruction. And I was going to be the booth girl, which was really exciting for me. And Gary Rumler came by the booth, and I met him. And that was like meeting, you know, like a rock idol for me, this, you know, Gary Rumler, who I had heard about, and I'd seen his work at Michigan. And he and George Geis were going to Disneyland after the presentation, so they invited me to go, which was the best part of the whole conference, was going to Disneyland with Gary Rumler and George Geis. And I must also mention that during my years at Michigan, I also met Karen Brathauer and invited me to accompany her on one of her consulting assignments. And so I'm so proud to say that I had Gary Rumler and Karen Brathauer as my mentors, and it just doesn't get better than that. After I graduated from Michigan, I got a short gig in New York with a big retail company in their corporate training department. They wanted to try out this new, exciting, experimental stuff. And I didn't know what the heck I was doing as a consultant. I was seeing stuff there that I was trying to positive reinforcement and trying to do, apply this technology that I had briefly learned at Michigan. And I called up Gary and I said, I asked him questions. I started asking, what do I do? I'm looking at salespeople, and I'm trying to apply this stuff, but they're not listening to me. In fact, they're telling me that they don't really care much what the salespeople do, because the merchandisers are really the important people in this organization, and as long as they have the right merchandise in the right place at the right price, as long as the salespeople don't, you know, overtly insult the customers, they're happy. I kept asking questions, and we had lunch, and he finally looked up and said, look, I think you're going to have to come work for us, because he couldn't answer my questions just over lunch. And since I really didn't know what I was doing at this organization and I needed a job, I said yes, and I went to work for Praxis in New York City. It was just an amazing experience. I learned every day. There were so many things to learn, organizations to learn about, and I was just telling somebody today, I never had a performance review in the entire time that I worked for Gary. I didn't have objectives.
And we never went over my objectives and reviewed them. As a matter of fact, later on when I worked for a real company and I had a performance review, it was a horrifying experience. After every consulting experience or visit or anything, what Gary did was he taught. He would just talk to you about what happened and what he observed and what I observed, and there were just ongoing performance reviews, which was teaching and learning. What do I want to talk about? It was interesting for me to see that after my name on the syllabus, there's like four or five other people speaking about Gary's career. Because in my mind, the Praxis years, we moved, by the way, eventually from Manhattan out to Morristown, New Jersey, because there was no longer a need to be in New York City, and there was a lot of corporate corporations moving out to New Jersey. Because to me, the Praxis years will always be the most important and most significant part of the technology and Gary's influence. It's like, I think Praxis in New Jersey was to Gary like Sgt. Pepper, the Sgt. Pepper album was to the Beatles, or Let It Bleed was to the Stones. You know, it was the exciting experimental years. You know, when we were, Karen's like, when, you know, we were just trying. We didn't always know the answers. We didn't know what we were doing. And we took the technology and we'd try to apply it, and we'd learn and we'd come back and write down what we learned, and things were being created with every single project that we did. I think that Gary's, and do I have, I see, okay.
One more slide.
I'm up to my slide maybe. I think Gary's biggest contributions during the Praxis years were his influence on the profession of, you know, what was called training, and that he took training from being a lowly cost function in organizations to being a central management function with demonstrable ROI. And he had a huge impact on this organization, which is now called ISPI for performance improvement, in that, you know, he spoke and he taught, and we developed the workshops, which I'm assuming many of you are familiar with, the performance analysis workshop, which popped up under other names, organizational performance management, which taught generations upon generations of people in the HR profession how to look at performance and how to make a difference in an organization. And it was a huge transformation in our field that occurred at that time in the 70s into the 80s. The workshop contained many powerful tools that we still use today in our field, front-end needs analysis. The performance analysis workshop was an integral part of the training organization at organizations like AT&T. They didn't move without doing a front-end needs analysis. Today, if you ask your client if they will do a front-end needs analysis, they act like you asked them to have an appendectomy without anesthesia. A front-end needs analysis? No, we don't need that, thank you. But at that time, people didn't embark on training unless they had done a thorough front-end needs analysis. And the organization mapping, and I asked Rick to we had walls of organization charts, you know, that we would use to map out and learn about an organization. I did work for the Warner Lambert's Chiclets factory, and we had that thing diagrammed, and I was in a meeting with the plant manager and his direct reports, and one of them actually said, because I was a young woman, and there weren't so many young women professionals at that time, and the guy said, and what does she know about our operation? And he said, shut up, she knows more than you do. Because I could show him on a piece of paper his organization. He knew that I understood the operation. I just want to say that Gary was the best boss that I ever worked for. And I think another one of his contributions was just creating that organization called Praxis, which was, to me, one of the best companies on the face of the earth. And I have a book, one of his books, inscribed to me, in which he says to Sarah, the best performance analyst on the planet, and if any of you that are speaking after me have an inscription, anything like that, don't tell me. Because it's one of my most precious possessions. It didn't feel to me, and I think to most of my colleagues there, like a business. Gary called it a not-for-loss organization. Those were not the big money years, you know. It felt, we had a mission. And that mission was not only to, you know, create and expand this amazing technology, but the mission was to make the world a better place by improving the place where people work. And I woke up every day feeling like I was making the world better because people spend so much time where they work, that if you made that a better place to be, the world would be a better place. So it was a phenomenal experience and a phenomenal time for me. There's a song by a country western singer named Trace Atkins, and I wanted to play a piece of that for you, but Rick said it was copyrighted and this is a business function, yada yada. So I'm actually going to sing a piece of this song for you because it so fits this occasion. And I will preface this by saying I have never sung in public before. And this is not an audition for American Idol. You're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look around. You're gonna miss these days when they're gone. You're gonna miss this. You're gonna miss this. Gary, I miss those days, and I miss you.
Thank you. Go ahead and stay here until Ellen comes up. So, Bill, what was it like being on the client side of Praxis?
Yeah, well, I think I lived in a different world than Sarah in the Breath House. When I joined Xerox, and I won't bore you with that, but it was a fast-growing organization. Our sales school was at the Sheraton Hotel, Fort Lauderdale, on the beach. And we flew first class, and we shot craps for our budget. And I was really the first one in our family to go to work for a business, and I thought, wow, have we missed it? I mean, this is terrific. And so I did that for a number of years. And then in the mid-70s, we got a call on a Friday afternoon. I always remember it, and it said, on Monday, you ought to report to corporate, and you are now in charge of sales and marketing education. I said, wow, have I screwed up? What happened to me?
Not on the video.
And we showed up on Monday. I showed up, and then two other men showed up. Ken Hansen from Field Services and a guy by the name of Frank Smith, who was a management specialist. And we sat there and waited for somebody to come. No one came. We waited on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, and on Thursday, I said, you know, I think we got a problem here. There's nobody else here except us. And so I called my boss, who had never shown up, and he didn't answer, so we called his boss. And we said, you know, we're here, we know it's a two-year assignment, should we just stay here for 2 years, or you want us to do something? He said, oh, I forgot to tell you that your boss has been reassigned, and you guys have to figure out what to do. So he sent us to Penn State for 2 weeks, which was quite different than going to Fort Lauderdale for 2 weeks, because they actually expected you to work, much to the surprise of all three of us. And one of the articles that we read was written by Gary Rumler. And I looked at that and said, it kind of makes sense. So I discussed it with my two colleagues. They said, yeah, but he's an engineer. Now, you know, I was at Xerox 7 years before I knew we had an engineering or a manufacturing department, because it wasn't important to me. So we invited Gary in, and of course, he drew his stick figures, boxes, circles, and Ken said, we're painting what to draw stick people? Because, you know, after all of our clients were in three-piece suits. I mean, it's very sophisticated. And so he actually developed a picture of Xerox Corporation, which had never been done before, because none of us actually knew there was engineering and manufacturing, and he kind of brought that to the floor. And so he actually showed us how these things got integrated and showed us where they were. I had never been to Webster, New York, where the R&D center was in manufacturing. I'd been to Rochester, but I didn't know they had a suburb called Webster. And my goal was never to go to Rochester, stay in Stanford. So he helped put that together. But I realized that I couldn't take an engineer into a sales marketing type organization. I mean, it just wouldn't fit. The other thing is, I assumed that he was old because he had gray hair by that time. And regrettably, he assumed I was old and wisdom because I had great hair. Turned out, neither one of us really had that much practical experience, even though he had a great theoretical base. And so we decided that we would take one of the senior Xerox executives to Morristown for one of those stimulating three-day workshops. The man I took was a graduate of the Latin School in Boston, graduate of Harvard, actually wrote part of his business plan in Latin, just to let us know that he was smart. But I figured if I could get him to believe this, we would have a prayer of changing the way we develop managers, especially at the branch level, and some of our future leaders. And so we went to Morristown for a great session in, I think, December or January, and it was really, for us salespeople, not overly stimulating, plowing through chart by chart these binders, which I thought were great bookends. But about 3 o'clock on Friday, it started to snow. And it snowed, and it snowed. And it was really clear we weren't going to get out. And about that time, Gary's partner, Tom Gilbert, started to drink. And those of you that remember Gilbert, he had a terrible chronic back problem, and he would tip a few. Well, he started about 3 o'clock on Friday, and the snow kept coming down, and we were there saying, you know, how are we going to get out? And all of a sudden, Gilbert, who is not able to stand up anymore, lays down on the main conference table. Well, my Xerox executive's mouth kind of drops, and Gary says nothing. I mean, I am looking at him like, you better have a job for me, because my career is over. And Gilbert started to speak. And all of a sudden, we're all standing around the table taking notes, because we realized it was Gilbert's next book. And it was great and was much better than the other 2.5 days sober that we had all gone through together. And at the end, Gary just said, let's talk tomorrow morning, because no one was coherent to talk on Friday night. So Saturday morning, we sat down, and he said, did you get it? And I said, not only did I get it, but the other executive got it. And you guys delivered, and we could now go back. And we began then to try and look at the organization really as an integrated system with people who did not want to look at it that way. And it, as the glory year started to end, it was became very, very important. But I always, like, I looked at the bar back there, and I thought it was a very appropriate prop for the end, and I volunteered to lay down, have a few, and explain the next theory. After the transition from Praxis came the Rumler Group, and about that time, I had moved on and had gone to Motorola at the request of the chairman to start an education institution, which eventually became Motorola University. And after I was there for a while, I realized it was time to bring Gary in because he was an engineer speaking to all engineers. I mean, as one person said, we never had a vice president of marketing because we never found a person with a golf handicap low enough. At that time, they had 40 vice presidents of engineering and 0 vice presidents of marketing. So I was the person on the new planet, and Gary was at home. And so we brought him in, and he began to assist us. He helped us design, along with Ray and others, a plan for the Motorola University system over time. He also developed a plan and began the tutorial of 27 people to understand what a performance-driven organization would look like and why we wouldn't be a traditional training organization. He helped create probably one of our most successful change programs called the Motorola Manufacturing Institute, which eventually became the Motorola Management Institute, which literally you could document, and Al would speak to some of it, savings of millions and millions of dollars. And also the realization that we didn't really know how the business fit together. Again, Al talked about, but that was a big aha. And then he also coached. We would rotate people in, just as we did at Xerox, and he really became the coach of the manufacturing manager who became his friend for the next 20-some years, Paul Heidenreich. But Paul was this manufacturing wild guy that was assigned to me. I mean, he's so wild. He lived in Scottsdale, Arizona. He had a sailboat, and he sat on his, you know, sat in the sailboat every Friday night having cocktails, wishing the water would find him. Okay, so, yeah, we gave Gary some really raw material that he did quite well with. He helped us develop the excellence. And one of the things I really loved about Gary, and it's already been spoken, is he learned while he gave. And of all the consultants we've worked with over the last 30-some years, there are less than a handful that learned and would share things that didn't work with you as well as things that worked. And we eventually, this was beginning to spread, so we were invited to run a three-hour program for the CEO and the COO and the vice chairman. And I said, Gary, this really has to be great, because if it's not, you know, we're right back where we were with Tom Gilbert. And so we went in, and the chairman was always very supportive. The COO really didn't like me at all. He thought it was an absolute waste of time. So he would begrudgingly sitting there. And Gary started drawing these stick figures and stuff. And you could see George just kind of eyes roll back. And all of a sudden, Gary rolled out the profile of the integrated organization known as Motorola. And I'll never forget, Mitchell said, I got it. It's the white spaces. He got it. Our seminar ended after 34 minutes because he got it. And then we were empowered to continue to move it through the organization. And because of that, we literally worked in sites all over the world. And I remember one, and we'll leave with this, one session is we were in UK. It happened to be the week of the 4th of July. And it was at a time when people still liked Americans. And so every night when we would come back, since the sun was still up, we'd go to a pub, which is where I found debriefing with Gary to be very helpful. And on Thursday, he said to me, we'd go, he says, Bill, do you realize we haven't had any food this week? And I said, yeah. I said, it is kind of strange, but I don't ever remember having a meal. He said, we haven't eaten at all this week because you keep taking me to these pubs. People like us, we're Americans, they buy us drink. We've celebrated the 4th of July 5 times. And I have to eat by Friday to wrap this sucker up, so we have breakfast. He also said something, and he said, beware of false prophets called HR people. Some of you are probably in that. But he said, they're coming in with whiz-bang tools. They're going to rank and rate you. They're going to assess you. They're going to tell you what you should be doing. But he said, but they don't understand the organization. They don't understand it. And it's very true, and over time, we were able to, I think, pick up on that. His contribution to me was he changed how I look at an organization. He also changed the view of the performer in the organization, and that quote of, you know, a bad system, a great performer will get the performer every time. And he also brought humor. We always had a great time, and with Gary, we always had two work days, the one you paid for, and then the one I really enjoyed, which was after the clock stopped, and we could really debrief, and he would tell me what he really thought of us, and we would do likewise. And I guess the final is, I never knew anyone who could make so much money selling so many companies as such a poor artist.
Thank you, Bill. Joining Bill in talking about the Rumler Group years is Alan Ramis, and Alan went on to be a colleague at the Rumler Brace Group and is now a partner in the Performance Design Lab.
Thank you. I first met Gary in 1981. Having recently joined Motorola, I was one of those people that Bill Wiggenhorn hired when he started up a training organization there pretty much from scratch. Nobody liked us then. Nobody knew what we were trying to do there. And so what Bill did was bring in a series of people to help us design the organization and begin to make an impact. And Gary was one of the first people who came in. And I was awestruck for two reasons. I was impressed with people who had gray hair. I was fairly young at the time, and both Bill and Gary had gray hair. So, but two, I had been a training manager for several years before taking that job. And I read an article called You Want Performance, Not Just Training, and it really changed the entire way I looked at what I was trying to do, changed the way I went about my work. And so I was already in awe of what this guy knew versus so many other things I had already learned. And then there he was standing in front of me, which just was kind of incredible. And Motorola turned out to be the opportunity of a lifetime for me personally. Just joining the company, I joined it at the right time because MTech, as it was called, the corporate training organization, had a huge impact on Motorola. And then after I was there about a year, about 1982, I was given the second opportunity of a lifetime to work with Gary and this wild manufacturing guy, Paul Heidenreich, to try to create what we first thought was going to be a training program for managers, and then it turned out to be a performance improvement methodology that we packaged and has since had a huge impact, not just on Motorola, but a lot of other companies. So I was lucky enough to get the assignment, work with those guys on doing that, and so that's what I want to tell you about, is how that methodology evolved, kind of impact it had on Motorola in those years, and then really has had legs because it's the kind of work that we've been doing ever since. So here was my job, though. I was about a decade younger than Gary and Paul, so that made me the kid. And the other thing I was kind of up against was my job was to try to capture what they were doing. And what they were doing changed every time they did it. So they went into different organizations, kind of created the methodology. I'd follow in behind. I'd try to package that. I'd go into the next session. I'd show them all this stuff. And they'd say, God, that's wonderful. That's not what we're going to do. my job was almost, you couldn't do it. I could not do my, and I had a deadline to provide a deliverable to him, and I finally did it, but I knew it was fairly shaky because what they were out there doing actually was not what was in that package, but that was kind of the best I could do. What I learned from that, though, as aggravating as it was in some ways, is that that's actually the way Gary worked. He worked on stuff, and 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 this turned out to be the earliest iterations of the methodology he continued to work on all of his life. So to show you a little bit of that, how it evolved, early on it was something called the organizational performance system. So it was a methodology for looking at a given organization, figuring out what the current design was, and then trying to ask some smart questions about how well that was working and how it might change, right? So the early version. And if we focus in on that box down at the bottom called situation analysis, these were the questions that were in the methodology at that point. What is happening now? What should be happening? Define your desired outputs. Well, today, that's known as as is and to be. It's turned into the core methodology in Six Sigma and BPM practice all over the world in all kinds of corporations. And very relatively few people know that this was the origin of this. Those two little questions, what's happening now and what should be happening, have now been picked up, adopted by people who don't even know that it actually came from Gary Rumler. But his impact has been enormous. And what I found out was, well, that's the way this is going to work. You're going to package it, and you're going to repackage it, and you're going to add to it, and it's going to evolve and get better and better and better, but it will never be perfect. So let me tell you a little bit about what then happened in those early years. So we packaged up this early version and started to try to use it. And this was Motorola at that time. It consisted of some major businesses. The one on the left-hand side is the semiconductor business. At that time, it was about 50% of the organization. So, you know, huge and made up of many divisions, product divisions inside. And so after I had worked on this program at corporate training, I was transferred out to the Phoenix area where the semiconductor business was. So my job changed at that point. I was a training manager out in the field. The semiconductor product divisions were my client. And even though I was a training guy, what I really wanted to do is I wanted to apply that methodology. So I started hunting for clients inside the semiconductor division, and after a little bit of work, started finding them. So the first one was a guy named Tommy George. He was a senior general manager. I know that doesn't sound like a senior general manager. In fact, he was a rather scary engineering PhD type, but his name was Tommy. But he had a new business, the ASIC business, that was not going very well and wanted some help. So this was our first opportunity. Critical business issue there was very bad time to market for this business called semi-custom. They were trying to compete with other organizations that were far ahead of them, so they were pretty unhappy about this. But the other thing about this is the way this new business was being developed and run is it actually crossed several existing organizational units, right? So it's a business built on top of other businesses. And so we gather them together using this methodology. And it was actually the very first time the senior managers had ever talked together about that business. Somebody had come up with that design, never pulled them together to say, guess what, you're all now in the ASIC business. So we did that and had them talk about what it is they were trying to accomplish in common. So we ran this workshop. It was the first real application of this performance improvement methodology out in the field. 2 weeks after the workshop, that division got moved to another group. So we thought, nice try, but we no longer have a client, it's dead. Now we had a new senior manager in there, so I spent 8 months going back to that senior manager and trying to convince him that he ought to take a look at what happened there. And for a considerable period of time, he was just not interested. Eventually, we convinced him to do that. Turns out, though, that even though the senior management had changed, the folks at the next level down liked that design so much that they put it in place and started to run the business according to that new design. And so it turned out, when we pulled them back together, that they'd actually cut cycle time in half, 14 weeks down to 7 weeks and nine months, without any particular direction from the top. And so that business, which actually looked like this, was one of the first real applications of the process improvement methodology. I know you can't see that very well, but you can see it well enough to see that what it illustrated for Gary, and this was the first time he said it to a management group, is, folks, you've got a lot of white space on that chart, which you have to manage. This was the first time he came out with that line. And, of course, that's what they were trying to do, manage across all of those interconnects, or lack thereof, between all of these business groups. So that was our first outing and highly successful. What we thought we could do on the basis of that was go right from that and find a lot of other clients. What actually happened instead was the semiconductor business went into the tank for about a year and a half, so we couldn't get anybody to spend any money on anything. But about 1987, we got involved in trying to revitalize this. Well, what Gary had been doing in the meantime is going out to other clients. He went out to GTE in particular, several other clients. He kept pushing the methodology further. So by 1987, this is what it looked like. And so now what you can see is the three levels, organization, process level, and job level, had been built into the methodology. So he came back to Motorola, and what we wanted to do in semiconductor is revitalize our business after going into a stall for a while by applying Gary's stuff in some of the same organizations that we had been in before. And so our first outing there was with a gentleman named Steve Hansen, who had actually been involved in that 1984 effort. Was a middle manager, now it stepped up to a product division, and as soon as he got up to that level, he said, I want to do that stuff we did back in 1984. So We took a look at his business, which wasn't across the international lines. In this particular case, was a huge order fulfillment process. Total cycle time at the beginning of the workshop was 17 weeks. 6 months later, based on that design, took it down to 10 weeks. 18 months later, down to 5 days. This is the one, this was the project that broke the dam. This is the one that got corporate attention and should have, and really got people interested in trying to redesign their businesses this way. So what that led to, and so what that means is this spread well beyond semiconductor, though that's where I stayed, and that's where my focus was. So just to add a little bit more then. So then we went on from there to work at a group level up from product divisions. So here's some data on what we did there. Worked across three divisions in the 87-89 timeframe, cutting days of cycle time out. And what we did was make an estimate of what we were saving for every day of cycle time. So the estimate is in that period of time about $13 million. I've been told by some people in semiconductor that's probably wrong by a factor of five. It was much more. But who cares when you're getting that kind of data? Also, Gary's stuff then, when it got back up to corporate level, was repackaged and put into Six Sigma programs. A lot of people don't know that, partly because of the title. They think the emphasis is on statistics. But it had always been a combination of TQM tools with process improvement tools. So Gary's stuff was integrated into Six Sigma. Motorola had by that time bought a license for Gary's stuff, and so they repackaged his material. And so what a lot of practitioners out in Six Sigma don't know is they're practicing some variation, there are many variations, but some variation of Gary Rumler's stuff. His contributions then at Semiconductor. He offered process improvement methodology throughout the sector, eventually got packaged in the Six Sigma program. He worked in every product division of Semiconductor. He worked in many of the other parts of the business, from corporate all the way down to department level. And he provided both measurable results and a way of talking about the business that we hadn't had before. White space, disconnects, the organization as a system, the whole concept of cross-functional processes came from him, and it had a huge impact and lasting impact on that organization. Of course, it went from there to many other places. So I was a very lucky person. Right time, right place, right? So his personal contribution to me was, frankly, he changed my life. He was incredibly generous. He was incredibly generous with his time, with his ideas, with his coaching, and I do miss him greatly.
Thank you, Alan. Yep, okay. So after the Rumler Group, there was a transition in that Alan Brace joined Gary Rumler, and it became the Rumler Brace Group. And so here to speak about the Rumler Brace Group years, we have Yvette Montaigne, a client of the Rumler Brace Group and later with Performance Design Lab, and Ron Bullock, who goes back to the Praxis years, but we've asked him to focus on
that.
Before that. And we've asked Ron to focus on the time at the Rumler Brace Group when he was both a colleague as well as a member of the management team.
Thank you, Ray. Well, like so many other speakers today, Gary was a huge influence to me and in my performance management as a teacher and a coach. He supported me throughout my career, and that really culminated with an offer to become his business partner in what was called then the Rumler Brace Group. The specific contributions, I've thought about them over the last few days and put them down on paper. And it was Dale and Karen talking about it and reminding me about that Michigan side, but in the 60s, taking, as a skills trainer, taking management of behavior change, that was reasons why people didn't do what they ought to do, was quite amazing. And then program instruction writing, both at the University of Michigan. But then after that, he had the gumption and the initiative to call and help and follow up and coach. And what he helped me do with the training department that I worked with in Northern Electric at the time, and you saw that was his first client up there, is we did something that really, really annoyed the engineering department. The little training department exceeded the entire engineering department's cost reduction goals for the year. with our program instruction and skills training changes that we made. And we were never all that welcome in engineering again. We got moved over to the HR group after that. And as my career evolved, then we added this performance analysis workshop stuff, this boot camp of all those boxes and stuff and binders and binders, and the process and organization level stuff and templates. But the evolving performance systems thinking and coaching over the years evolved. And then along with his partner, Alan Braish, they helped me and two fellows I was working with in Toronto, Canada at the time, John Kittredge and Andrew Spanny, and we became his first franchised Rumbler Braish group in another country. So this was a bargain. We got... Isn't it awful? You go back, the first facilitator group, and the guy that I always loved is the one, the bald-headed guy, and his name is Michael Hammer, but he wasn't the Michael Hammer. He called himself the other Michael Hammer, and a very young Rick Rumbler, and Alan Braish, and Paul Heidrich there. The deal was for 10% of the action, Alan and Gary gave us this, you know, book that was doing so well and was, it was such a door opener in getting into business. They provided the coaching support and the training support to us, and boy, did we go to town. We built a great business in Canada. In fact, we built such a good business that it almost exceeded what he was doing in all of the United States, and of course, we're only a tenth. So at that point then, Gary thought that it wouldn't be such a bad idea to eliminate the white space between our organizations. And so we became partners in the Rumbler Braish Group. And so that was the end of the line between the countries, and we just went where the action was. Together in the Rumbler Braish Group now, we built an international performance management and improvement consulting and training firm that saw us and our associates and affiliates grow Rumbler Braish Group revenue exponentially. It was just amazing. I mean, it was, as we used to say in those days, marketing was answering the telephone. The process view and process improvement really had legs, and it took off, and we just couldn't do enough to keep up with that whole field. It was wonderful. But whenever we did that, we always applied Gary's business model of always offering clients the opportunity of learning to be able to do this sort of stuff themselves. And because of that, and of course the copyrighted material that, you know, had a great margin to it, they became competent. And I mean, we trained thousands and thousands of executives and managers and facilitators, and the permutation. I guess today, you know, it would be like that. It was much slower then, but you know, that amazing woman that showed up on the YouTube this week in Scotland that went on that thing, and she, all of a sudden, 45 million hits. Well, it didn't happen that fast, but it wasn't, it had the same sort of effect, because you found that one person in this group, they tried something, they moved to another company, and they took it with them, and it did become the language of business for how to improve performance from our perspective. One of the fellows, and I'd asked a couple of friends of mine to comment about it, but Michael Flanagan, and he was at GTE when we had done the work there, and he really gave Gary and the methodology a lot of credit for when they won the Malcolm Baldrige Award, and now he's the head of executive training at Verizon. But and this was just a heartfelt comment he made over an email to me this week. I've never looked at things the same way anymore. My lens and frame are forever changed as a result of Gary's profound influence. And that was really the that contribution. In retrospect, it was this side, this changing the lens through the way the rest of us trainers and performance people saw the world, that was his true legacy to the worlds of business and government and military organizations. And as everybody here has attested to, and as Yvette will as well as a client, and I'm sure the informal session will reinforce, that he really did make a difference in this field.
So I met Gary in 1996, and I think my experience kind of replicates what a lot of people have talked about. He changed my professional life. I didn't know what I was doing. I had been hired to be the training director at Louisiana Pacific, and this was a time where they were just about to go under. Their stock price had like fallen by 75%. They had class action suits against them for some of their quality flaws. They had been fined severely by the Environmental Protection Service, like EPA, in terms of our practices. So they had brought in a new CEO, and then they had also hired me to, they had already started. They said, well, we're going to fix this place with process. So they hired me to say, all right, we've got the joiner quality training. We're going to have you train everybody in the organization, and we're going to fix all of our problems. I came in with a background in organizational communication and leadership development, so I really didn't know much about quality or process, but I did know that we did not have the right plan in place. There were many, many consultants there from Anderson Consulting, from Pricewaterhouse. Everyone was ISOing everything, then documenting our current state. I couldn't figure out why, because it didn't seem like it was working. So the first couple of weeks that I was there, I just tried to look at everything that was happening, try to find the answers somewhere else. So I can't tell you, I read every book I could think of that had a solution to it. And until I found the managing the white space, I didn't have a solution. And nobody was going to have a solution. So we called in Gary, and he talked to us. And from the moment he was there, I knew that we could put together a plan that could help save the organization. And we did. For the next 4 years, we worked on different things. We did several order fulfillment processes for some of our major businesses. One of those businesses, within the first 6 months, we had realized $2.3 million in extra sales realization. We had put in place quality management systems and environmental management systems across all different facilities, hundreds of them. Well, 100 of them. We had the plan to do that. We had trained over 35 performance and process improvement facilitators who helped do different things across the organization. We did 9 sites where we thought we were going to have to close them. We went in there with the process and were able to make sure that they were profitable again. We even used the human performance model to design our whole manager training around that, so to teach people how to help manage human performance, and showed behavioral outcomes in terms of improved management skills within 2 years. So it made a big difference, and like they said, working with Gary was always something that helps you see things in a different way. You can never see things the same way after you've had that experience, and I take it to everything I do. Thanks.
Thank you.
There was one exception. It wouldn't be fair to not speak to that, I guess. It was a really cold day in February, and it was Detroit, in one of the 3 auto firms, and in an executive boardroom, and it had been a long sales effort. Man, oh man, the trouble we went through to end up in that room, and we were in the middle of making the pitch, and Gary was at his stick man again, and boxes and arrows, and all of a sudden the polite word would be the key decision maker, the financial buyer, interjected a comment and said, "Do you guys know where you are?" And Gary, you know, never kind of really slow at anything like that, just looked at his watch and said, "Well, it's the 15th, it must be Detroit." And he continued on. And the guy said, no. He said, "Do you know where you are?" And so Gary said, and then he, you know, and I could see it coming, you know, down went the pen, and he looked at the guy and he said, "Enlighten us." And the guy said, "You," he said, "are in the largest corporation in the world." He said, "Our revenue is bigger than most countries' gross national product." He says, "We had more employees than Hannibal had in his army. What the hell are you going to be able to tell us? And what are we going to learn from you about cycle time and cost and customer satisfaction?" And there was just this silence and this loud snap when all the slides got, you know, put back in the book. And Gary said, not a single thing. And so out we went. And on the way out, and it was a very fast exit, Gary said, well, I guess nobody's going to learn anything here today, meaning us too. And that was really, you know, that was who he was. But the comment revealed his real passion, which has been spoken to, learning and sharing that learning. And I don't know how many times I've heard him say, so what did we learn from them, or what did we learn from that? And then he would sort of figuratively take out that butterfly net, you know, and grab the idea, stick it in his binder, press it for another day, and then out it would come, sure enough, with some more stick men and boxes and arrows on it, you know, but you'd have another tool. So, that was my Gary.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you, Yvette. So Gary Rumler sold the Rumler Brace Group and retired. And so for many people, we thought that was the end. He was officially in the fourth quarter, and he had rules for what he was willing to do and not willing to do in the fourth quarter of his life. But there was a resurrection. And so here to talk about the resurrection are my current partners in Performance Design Lab, Alan Ramos, back up again, and Cherie Wilkins.
So for those of you who don't know me, I am Cherie Wilkins, and I have had the extraordinary pleasure of working with Gary since about 1994, and I ran into him at DuPont, where I was a communications consultant, and I was put on a team that DuPont had put together, several consultants, all asked to play nicely, if you can imagine, about five different consultants. One of which was the Rumler Brace Group, and they were doing a lot of the business analysis, business mapping for DuPont. And my firm, which was the communications consulting firm, was also asked to manage all of these huge charts that turned out to be super system maps and process relationship maps for all of DuPont's divisions. And so I had to I had that department under me, and I had to manage all of that as well. And I began to look at these things and say, well, what are we trying to communicate with these things? And that led to figuring this stuff out. And they said, well, here, if you read this book, it will help. And so I read that, and like so many others, just it was a defining moment. And I said, aha, now I understand. There's the model for how the world works. And from then on, it changed my life. And eventually, they asked me to join the team because I had the audacity to make some suggestions for how they might improve those tools. And so they invited me over to their side, and my life was just completely changed after that. So that was where I started, and I'm currently his partner with Rick and Alan in Performance Design Lab, which really came about because Gary only failed at one thing ever, and that was retirement. And really, what it was his recognition that it just, the world still didn't get it. He hadn't influenced the world the way he wanted to. The process piece, as Ron and Yvette told you, just took off like gangbusters, but it was focused on process, and Gary knew there was more to it and wanted to focus on other things like the management and so on. So he felt he had to get back in the game, and thus the lab was born in 2000. It actually started with Rick's younger brother, Matt Rumler, and Kimberly Morrill, Dale Breathauer, and Carolyn Smalley. So they, Kimberly and Matt were the first two partners, then Rick and I came along, and then lastly Alan, and he'll tell you when he joined kind of what the focus was then. But so the focus was more on the management system. We had started a lot of that work at Rumler Brace, and we were trying, and it was always kind of, for those of you who are familiar with the Rumler Brace stuff, it was phase five. So you kind of did all the improvement, and then the afterthought was the management piece, and it was always, there were the four phases, and then it was the fifth phase, and that really wasn't working. It needed to be more integrated. It needed to be the focus. So that became a lot of what we were doing at Performance Design Lab in the early parts. The other piece was the focus on value creation, because the other thing that happened to process is it went down in the weeds. And so everything suddenly became a process. It became adopted, and the functional kings and queens won once again, and process was subsumed into the functions, not crossing the white spaces. And so we weren't getting really the results that we'd gotten in all the early years and all the things that we'd spoken of working across the white spaces. And so it was how to bring process back up, and we began to talk about value creation, which really had to cross all of the white spaces. So in Gary's opinion, it was the most valuable insight that was just had not fulfilled its full potential, and so we had to get back in the game. But there was always this tension, because now we're in the fourth quarter, we're living in paradise as far as Gary was concerned. And so there was the tension of, do I want to go back on the road and learn from the clients, which was always a rich experience, or do I stay home in paradise? And so we tried as much as possible to bring the clients into the lab. I know Yvette and others came to Tucson, came to paradise and worked with Gary. And then it was up to us to go out and work the projects and bring back. I had to, on many occasions, recreate exactly what happened in the project for Gary so that we could begin to noodle it on the whiteboard, the still functioning whiteboard, same one. I'm sure you've all seen it. And in fact, there he is at the whiteboard, and we would recreate the experience, and so he could get the learning that way. And every once in a while, we could make him get the suit and the tie back out and visit a client. So, but always that tension. And the other piece that you have heard that has been just continuous throughout Gary's career was the sharing of what was learned. And so here you see it in all its various, I love this slide because you see it in all its various forms. What was the BCW workshop became the PAW workshop, became the CPE workshop, became PAD, which I was Rumler Brace, and I taught it there. It was performance analysis and design, and I used to teach that with Gary. And then became performance analysis for results, and then finally serious performance consulting, and along with that, the book came out that embodied a lot of that. But Gary always had to have a vehicle in which he could package up all that he had learned, all of his experience about performance consulting, and bring that really to all of you. And that what we knew about that vehicle was it was never the same. So all of you who think you've taken the version of SPC, you took a version, it was a unique version, and that course never existed again. They were a moment. Every one of these workshops was only a moment in time, and your experience was completely unique. And that's the way it always would be. And that was what Gary did. The moment he learned it, we knew, as product manager of those workshops, it's a nightmare because everything changes. The moment we learned it or found a better way to articulate it, all the materials changed, everything changed. So, and that was just the legacy that we always knew we would have. So just in terms of the later contributions, in terms of models, you've seen the human performance system, and you've seen the swim lane maps and the white space in the original. What we've been working on at the lab, some of the latest thinking was really a lot of it about value creation hierarchy. That came about because of Gary's realization that process had gone down too far, had been subsumed, was in the functions, wasn't crossing white space. And so this became the articulation in the way of getting across that, okay, we understand where you are, you're at one level, you need to bring it back up where you can see value actually being created. That requires crossing those white spaces. And understand that, yes, process can be many things, but it's also many levels. So we knew where we were working and also knew at what point we had to get high enough to be able to connect to value. So that became the later articulation of that. And then with that, that was the work that had to be managed. With that came the management system to manage the work. And that work has been going all along. I actually remember the stories Gary would tell me. So my introduction to management system was the Sarah Morgenstern stories of Sarah sitting in the chewing gum factory, where she had a list of questions that managers were allowed to ask. So because Sarah had got the whole system articulated for them, and so the manager's reaction, or at least the way Gary told the story, was, at last, I know the son of a gun to wring their neck. And Sarah would say, nope, these are the only 5 questions or so that you can ask. What has happened? How can I help you to keep the managers from having the wrong reaction? And that was the early changing managers. And then that went through to phase 5. And then finally, we got better and better and better of matching up the work that must be managed with the way in which you must manage. And that became a great deal of our focus. And so a lot of the later models you'll see really articulate the relationship between organization level, value creation level, process level, putting function level management, where it appropriately needs to serve process and value creation, and then linking that down to human performer as well. So we got better at articulating that, and that was a big piece of what we were doing. It went under many names: performance measurement and management system, PPMS, org IQ, MOAS, and you'll recognize, I'm sure, a lot of those names. And then?
Okay, so where I went after Motorola actually was to the Rumler Brace Group. So I continued working with Gary for another 8-9 years. Rumler Brace Group was sold off in the late 90s, and so then I went my own way for several years, ran my own business, continued to do performance consulting, but was on my own, kind of in the wilderness, actually, sometimes felt like. And then in about 2004, 2005, I was at a conference. I had a glass of wine in my hand, turned a corner, and there was Gary with a glass of wine in his hand. And before you knew it, I had joined PDL. And it was like, well, we just talked yesterday, didn't we? It was very cool. And there were a couple things that were interesting when we started talking about where we had been and what we had been doing. One of the things that I had started doing after leaving there was, as Cherie said, a lot of that process work started getting dumbed down to single processes. And what I was finding after I went out is what organizations really needed is they needed to work at a larger scale. Actually, back where we started with Motorola, they needed to take on whole businesses. They needed to understand their architecture of processes. And so that's where I was beginning to gravitate. And then the other thing that was happening to me is every time I turned around, I was dealing with IT people, because technology had become so pervasive, it was getting entwined with processes. So they were sometimes my client, sometimes my adversary, but one way or the other, they weren't going away. So I was focusing more and more on them as a potential client. When I got together with these folks, I found out that essentially both those same things were happening. They were scaling up, and they were beginning to recognize more and more that IT was a potential collaborator and an entity we needed to learn about and get smarter about and to integrate into our work. It's an example there of a swim lane chart with technology built in. And we went back to school, basically, to understand BPM and what that was all about and who those vendors were and how all of that then could enrich our understanding of an impact on organizational performance. So it was a very nice blending of knowledge. The other thing that was interesting about rejoining PDL is that I was considerably older at that time, so now I was kind of an old duffer, and I shared a lot of the same aches and pains that Gary did, unlike these guys. So I remember one of the very first times I taught a class with them, typical thing, we taught the first day. That night they wanted to change a lot of things. They were up till about 10 or 11 o'clock at night. They were changing all these slides, and I could not stay awake. I mean, I had to go to bed. And so the next morning I saw Gary and I said, I'm working with children. I can't do this. So some of the rules that Gary had set down for how often he'd get on a plane and how patient he would be with clients, that sort of stuff. I started asking for some of those rules for myself, so I am now the official old guy. But anyway, so IT is one of the things that we have focused in on more and more. The other thing that we have focused in on, and is actually the subject of a book coming out in September, is we became clearer and clearer that what we had been working on and trying to articulate for a long time is that there are two dimensions of a business. There is the value creation dimension, which is where processes reside, but on a larger scale, it's how work gets done and how value gets produced for the market. And in opposition to that, unfortunately, in many cases, there is the resource dimension, which also has to be managed. And it's that tension between those two dimensions that we've been working on all along. And so the book is our latest articulation, and I hope our clearest articulation of what those dimensions are and how one can manage both of them. So, two new books coming out. One is aimed at practitioners of process methodology, but lifted, as I've just said, considerably higher to a much larger scale, which with much more impact, as well as pulling in technology. And then a companion book that we hope to get out in 2010 that is aimed at management, because what we discovered is there were two readers for IP. There were managers and then there were practitioners, so in this case we decided why not a book for each of them. And there is more to come. Certainly some of the questions we got about PDL is, are you going to stay in business, where are you heading with this? And what I can tell you very simply is we are honored to be partners of Gary, and our job will be to carry on that legacy.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Sheree. Everybody you've heard from has multiple decades of experience working with Gary in either as a colleague or as a client. And so sometimes we forget that there are people who are relatively new to the thinking. And the last component is the broader field, kind of what's the look ahead. And we thought that some people who would be great to speak to that are people who have only come to know Gary in the last decade. And I think the consensus is that they probably feel like they've known him for multiple decades as a result of that time. So I'd like to introduce Gonzalo Rodriguez, I apologize, and Klaus Wittkund to speak about the broader field. My pleasure.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Well, very briefly, but when we got to know Gary, it was associated with an idea that we had. That's why we says a bunch of dreamers at the Performance Improvement Institute. And I say a bunch of dreamers because when Dale Bredhauer heard our conference in Vancouver at the ISPI conference, when we left, he said, I want to participate in that project, and I will invite someone. The idea was to change society. So imagine the client is society. The client society. The results are for society. So where is the process? The organizations are part of a process. So you have to work through value chains, but societal value chains. So what he said about if you put a good performance against a bad process, the process will win almost every time. Wait a second, you have to change the whole system. So he took the challenge to help us to change the system. That's why he believed that it could be possible to create a prosperous society by constructing a good system that will hold successful organization and generate superior results. Here, he was creating value. He was operating outside of any organization. That's why the second part is we cannot work as we have been working if we would like to have a different result. So he's, so in a meeting at his house at the Paradise, imagine Roger Kaufman, Dale Bredhauer, Jose Angel, and myself evaluating 1 year. Mariano is the director of the Institute, and thinking how we were going to do it in order to impact society. So they decide to do this, a cluster. So each one will be the manager of an area in such a way that the students were going to be the ones that operate that organization, that will help the institutions. Because now you have a process of organization. The functions are the institutions. What that means? The function is for government. The function is for the university. The function is for the enterprises. The function is for the non-governmental organizations. So we have to generate a high level results. As a professor and consultant, focus on practical learning, work through projects and practical cases, help his students to acquire tools to solve practical problems, and he was always available for students. We were lucky because he traveled. And he gave two courses, organizational performance improvement and performance accomplishment systems. Well, the Sonora Institute of Technology in Northwestern New Mexico have been touched very closely by Gary. Thanks.
Muchas gracias.
I never met somebody who shared his know-how and material so openly and freely like Gary did. And the reason behind it is very simple, I think, and has been mentioned several times. He was a learner. And if you want to ensure that the discussions you lead with people finally are a learning experience, you have to ensure that they know enough. So he threw all this stuff at you, like, this is already here, we know that, what is next? And I think this question, what is next, was the question that connected us over the last more than 10 years. This is obviously what I didn't know when I first encountered his ideas. This was reading his first book in Germany. But before I had read half of the book, I knew that if I ever would have the chance to have a sabbatical, I would use it and to go and meet this guy and learn. I never had a sabbatical, but finally I had the chance to learn to know him. I do not even remember what was the first meeting. I only remember one of the first ones. This was a bar in a hotel in San Francisco, and it was the old shots like Don Tosti, Bob Carlton, probably Claude Lineberry, standing at the bar, exchanging war stories, you know, and me being next to them, feeling a little strange because not being integrated, but I had to wait for my chance to learn to know him. And then Margaret came, and I introduced myself to Margaret using my name and said, I'm a fan of your husband. And she looked at me, I think she didn't even laugh. She said, yes, I am too. And then I thought, okay, I have something in common with a family member, might be a good start. But it wasn't a breakthrough concerning the relation to Gary. The breakthrough was finally Roger. He set us up to teach the Institute together with him and Lynn Kearney. And the teaching was not the real thing. We had an instantaneous connection, I think, because of this learning. And we enjoyed the time when Roger took over or Lynn took over, and we could sit in the corner or we could step outside and start to discuss. This was the real thing, not the teaching. And then this, we enlarged that, you know, because the time at conferences is always short, so it was, we never had enough time to finish our discussions. Then we continued. He came to Germany. He invited me to Tucson, so it went on and went on. And finally, because it developed into an interest in systems thinking, finally it ended in October last year when he set up what he called his first conference on systems thinking. Great experience. On invitation only, 4 people invited, 1 couldn't make it, so we ended up being 3. And we really worked. We worked all the time. And you can imagine, this was quite a dense experience. Have you ever experienced a conference where you have access to all presenters all the time? And if you look at all this, like 30% of the presenters was brilliant. Can't be better. This is how we, let's say, how we exchanged ideas, and it helped us very much. It changed completely what we did in our company and finally led to, we put the consulting part, the business consulting part out of the company, made it a new one, and labeled the new company Performance Design International on purpose to show that there was a proximity to Performance Design Lab. Because, and this is comes to how this influenced the broader field. Luckily, we got some projects in Southeastern Europe and in Asia, and we were sent to those countries to set up organizations. Projects we never got in Germany. Like in Germany, when they call you as a consultant, you have one single problem to solve, and you do not check, like assess a whole organization. But this is what we did there. The first phase always was like go in and check the whole organization. And when we got the first request, I knew right away, yes, we can do it, because the framework is in place. Gary's framework, you know, being coherent and being scalable up and down to basically any size, automatically provided it. And this is what we did then. We used this, and you easily can see that. We started with a super system and then went down step by step, covering the 3 levels of performance and finally setting up management systems behind that. Very easy, very easy. It's like once you have it, then it's easy. To develop it probably is not that easy. It took him more than 30 years or 40 years. We did that with a number of organizations meanwhile, and we are not the only one. So we spread the ideas in those projects, but there are others working with his ideas also. KNO, which is the company of Stephen Kelly and Mary Novak. Stephen Kelly is currently a board member. They work in the same field, and they work with the same ideas, though it is spread in many more countries than the ones you can see here on the slide, because KNO works in different countries also. The last thing we have been working on, and this is like future perspective, or it should have been the future perspective, is based on what we discussed in Spain. Gary became also very interested in a more detailed approach concerning systems thinking, and we developed the idea that it might be possible to integrate what they do at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, you know, with business dynamics, and the things Singy did in his book with this archetypes, that we could be able to connect that, you know, with all the models he developed and you developed meanwhile in PDL. Unluckily, unluckily, this will at least not take place in the way he thought it would. Probably one last remark. My father passed away 2.5 years ago. And although I know this is a crazy idea, it helped me to imagine that he was a new star in the skies. And I could see him at night. And if it were up to me, Gary would be the next one up there. And from time to time, we could see him. Thank you.
I think you have to remember Gary had an ISPI life also, as you mentioned earlier.
Yes.
I was a past president, as you all know, life member, chartered CPT, and institute faculty member. He was one of the originators of the institutes and helped me over the years do that, so that was great. He's also a mentor, I think, to many of us. I think we all would agree on that. One of the things I think we have to do, though, before we wrap this up, is that about 4 or 5 years ago, in the institutes, he always started off as that he needs to pronounce his name correctly. So what can you lead us maybe into how his name is actually said, as opposed to the way we usually say it?
Actually?
Yes.
Geary Rumler.
Yes.
Dr. Geary Albert Rumler.
So he always prided himself at the very beginning, because I think he has a grandson with a similar name.
He does. The next Geary Rumler is in the room.
There's also some of the people we'd like to remember during this time, because Gary knew these people. Geary knew these people as well.
Yes.
And there's Richard Garrison has also passed away during this last year. Dick Lincoln a couple of years ago were people that we'd like to recognize. Sue Markle, that was one of the first presidents of ISPI. I think she was the first woman president of ISPI, actually. Bob Morgan, who was at the University of Florida. Certainly, Geary Rumler and
Frank
Whitereth were all there. And then, certainly, one person has been mentioned is George Geiss.
Yes.
All the way through this. So I think that's important for us to remember as well. What we'd like to do now is, one thing I have to tell you, too, is that several years ago, I had an opportunity to go down to visit your dad. And he was gracious enough to open up his library to us. And to Carol Haig and to Lynn Kearney and myself, and that's where we started the book for ourselves. So if you read our book, you'll see not the work. We talk about the work, worker, and workplace, very similar,
yes.
And use many of the models. And Gary was always, I think we've been hearing today, opened up to us everything. And you'll see those in our book as well. So we appreciate that.
Well, thank you. Yeah,
and thank you.
Always willing to share, and I hope we take that forward as a group of professionals going forward, that we continue to share in his memory.
So we know that we've lasted a little bit longer, but we got a little late, but it's hard to put these down in such a short time we had. We'd like to turn, maybe Margo has a microphone, and maybe one or two stories that some of you all may have. This is being videotaped, and if you have a story that you'd like to share with us, please help.
Yes, I do, and at the risk of taking us backwards now, I must, because I, as a line manager with the telephone company, the Pacific Telephone Company, had been using George Odiorn's work. And when I was appointed to set up the first internal performance improvement group in the Pacific Telephone Company, I'm not sure my check was the first one in to Gary, but I had the good fortune to learn about the Center for Program Learning for Business. And where's Karen? Because I hired Gary and Dale Breathour and Karen Breathour and Joe Ganey to come and help me develop my first staff of 8 people to do this performance improvement across 3 different departments. So I think that what I would like to say to Karen and Dale and Joe and Gary is that behavior that is changed can be maintained. And I am still applying in my professional work what I learned from those people. And then in later years, having the privilege of being co-faculty with Gary in the institutes or sharing time and space and some good meals with Margaret and Gary as we did the Pro Series, I very much treasure the learning.
Maybe others in the group that would like to share a story or two or have an opportunity?
It's a little intimidating talking after people who knew Gary a lot more than I did. I met him in 92, and my second project with the Rumler Brace Group, I got to work directly with Gary. I was a Canadian. I got brought on board by Ron Bullock and some of the Canadians, and the first project we debriefed in New Jersey, and I guess out of that I got invited to be part of a Shell E&P computing project. Now, I thought that was the birth of Gary thinking about management process as a process, but maybe Sarah had it before that. But I still am going to tell the story. I had a computing background, so we were to map these processes. So we mapped the applications development process and the operations of computing process. We mapped all these computing processes, and we're sitting there with maps all over the hotel room, the Hyatt, I think, at that point. And it was very, very interesting watching Gary realize that we're missing something here. It isn't anything to do about how the work's done. That's not what the issue is. The issue is around how they're being managed and how the money is flowing and how, you know, if you try and hold IT to a budget, what happens in an organization's behavior is that money gets spent out the back door. You know, you can spend a lot of computing equipment on drilling oil wells out there. So it was really fascinating. It was a fantastic opportunity for me to work with them, and I enjoyed working with them for the next 10 years or so. The other quick story, probably on that project, I came from an insurance background, and I remember Gary asking me how on earth I ever stood working in an insurance company for the number of years. And I apologize to anyone here who works in life insurance. But it actually rang a bell because I realized I'd moved, you know, within companies every couple of years because I was bored. And he had this theory of a business of how many brains it took to run a business. And in his theory, I think it was a consumer products company that you had to do R&D well, you had to do the quality of manufacturing well, you had to figure out what your market wanted, you had to sell it, you had to deliver the whole thing. That's what took the brains. And at the bottom was insurance. It was a bookkeeping organization. That's my story.
Thank you, Allison.
Karen, I took us back to 1965.
I can't tell all the stories, but the first time I met Gary was in the halls of, in Washington, D.C., the halls of OEO. We were both starting to do Job Corps together. If you don't know, Job Corps was turned over to the our profession, and we designed it. And when we first saw each other, I think we thought each other was a Job Corps kid. Okay, that's how young we were. One of the last things I did was Gary's last master's presentation here at ISPI. I had the honor of introducing him. So I got up there, and I started introducing him, and I went on very fluently about all the contribution he'd made to the organization, how much I had learned, how much I really cared for it and stuff and so forth and so on. And as I handed him the plaque, he says, "Are we engaged now?" So.
I had the pleasure of going to work out of college up in Saginaw, Michigan, and I worked with two colleagues who had worked with Uncle Rick, Gary's brother, Rick, and so I became a Rumlerite. People have asked me, is that Rumler Light or Rumlerite? But and then I had a chance to go to work at Motorola, working for Bill Wiggenhorn and with Alan Remus. And got to work on a lot of projects with Gary originally. Paul Heidenreich was my boss too, the crazy manufacturing guy. And I just remember a couple of Gary quoting Popeye. And I always remember him saying, "I am what I am." And he was a very generous person. He bought a copy of Tom Wolfe's book, The Right Stuff. And we enjoyed talking about that book when that first came out before the movie and everything, and just have so many fond memories of working along with Gary and Carol Panza at the time and Paul Heidenreich, and it was a great learning experience, and while I don't practice it exactly as he has kept on changing it, who could keep up with it unless you were right by his side, but I value all that so tremendously. Very important to all of us here, obviously.
Well, most of you don't know me, and I didn't know Gary very well at all. My name is Deborah Westlake, and I'm fairly new to ISPI. So what I want to speak to is to his kindness. It was my first convention, and I didn't know a single person there. And I was looking somewhat forlorn, and a man introduced himself and asked me what I knew about ISPI and why I was there and what did I want to accomplish, and told him my desires and a little bit about my background. And I asked him which courses he would suggest, which ones were the best, and who he thought I should go with. And he said, "Well, I think there's a couple," and he didn't mention himself. And I said, "Well, I've heard there's a guy named Gary that's pretty good, and what do you think?" And he said, "Well, I think he'd be pretty good. I think you'd be interested in hearing him too as well." And he said, "Do you know where you're going?" And I said, "No, but you seem to be like you're in a little bit of a hurry." And he said, "I am, but let me show you where you'd like to go if you'll tell me." And so I went, and then it wasn't later, much later, that I found out that he was actually very distinguished and important and yet took time to be passionate and share his consideration and courtesy with someone who knew very little, and he was preparing for something very important for a lot of people. But obviously that spoke to, it didn't matter whether it was one person or a lot of people's lives he was touching. So I wanted to come tonight just because he touched me.
Thank you. I think it would be fair to say that Gary did fail retirement, but he also failed at political correctedness.
Right, yes, I agree. I remember I stayed up in the house one time with the office, and Michael and I were visiting, because Margaret was going to change the house. And we couldn't come down all day long because they were painting. And finally it was cocktail time. We were doing martinis at the time. We went down, and Margaret had and Michael had painted the fireplace purple. It turned out great, though, and I think Gary actually ended up liking it. Well, I know he ended up liking it. And then that's when the house started being remodeled. So that was another change, though. Thank you, Margaret, for letting Michael redo your house.
So on that note, what I'd like to do, since we're coming up to time, I'd like to acknowledge the Rumler family members that are here. My mother, Margaret Rumler. Mom, can you stand up? My sister-in-law, Shung-Yi Rumler, and her son, and Gary's grandson, Gary Rumler. My wife, Marnie Rumler, and my daughter, Lucy Rumler. Thank you for coming. And thank you again to all the presenters. I greatly appreciate all your hard work and making the trip, and in many cases just to be here for this tribute. And so thank you very much. We'll give one last round of applause for the presenters, please.
And there is a book in the back if you'd like to sign it. It will be here, and then we'll also have it outside the remainder of the next day, so they'll be able to do that. We'll give that to you. And this was videotaped, so we'll have a videotape for you also.
All right.
Great. Thank you. And thank you.
Thank you.